Hello, this is Madeline Lim here at Lowin, and today I'm here with our managing partner and attorney, Mr. Jacob Lee. Hi, Jacob.
Hello. My name is Jacob. I'm your criminal defense lawyer. Glad to see you again.
Yeah, glad to see you again. He's our lawyer. Today we'd like to talk about sexual crimes, particularly indecent assault by force. How such an offense is established, and what you need to do if and when you are accused of such a crime. And first of all, Jacob,
yes.
How does Korean court or law enforcement deals with it or sees it when it comes to sexual crime?
Okay, if you can be punished for indecent assault by force, even if you didn't touch directly the body of the accusers.
Really?
In Korea.
How is it possible?
It is a very different reason, but there are several rulings that sentence the simple act of stroking the head or the pulling the wrist without force as indecent assault by force.
So this can be indecent assault by force?
Yes, right.
Oh.
Yes.
Okay.
And in Korea, the act of indecent assault is a felony, nothing but a felony.
Oh, not a misdemeanor.
And not a misdemeanor.
Oh.
Yeah, so, and the Korean Supreme Court has judged touching anybody of women consist of indecent assault by force. So you need to be very careful. Touch someone's person in Korea.
So it sounds like the landscape, the sexual crime landscape in Korea is very harsh, very strict. But also I heard that there are many cases of falsely accusing or maliciously accusing for sex crimes.
Yes.
So tell me about it.
So if you are falsely accused by indecent assault by force, here are the seven steps.
Oh, seven steps?
Yeah, I can share you.
Wow. Okay, please.
Okay, you must follow these steps.
Okay, ready?
First, remain silent. You don't say anything. And second, establish your timeline in detail. And three, obtain your witnesses. And four, preserve evidence in three ways.
Three ways.
Uh-huh. And make your story in detail, based on facts, and testing or not about the polygraph.
Polygraph.
That is a big question.
Ah, to do or not to do, that is the question.
Okay. And the last thing is dress up charm, and your feeling, your emotion is very important.
That matters too.
In your interrogation stage.
Really? I think it's the opposite way. I mean, I'm honest. I mean, I have to defend myself, explain. I have to say more, but you said shut up?
You think so. But I don't agree with your opinion because you must not act or react merely according to your own thoughts and feelings in the first place. It is very dangerous. So you need to check your plan for your case. And you don't say anything to anybody until you prepare it.
So even to your family or friends?
Yes, right. It's very important to remain silent until you have your own plan for defense this case.
But you can share it with your family or spouse at least. Why not?
They will also be interviewed by police. So you can remember your anything you say to and texting anybody can work against you. Will work against you.
Even texting.
Yes, right.
So I think Attorney Jacob Lee said is that anything you say will probably work against you, even to your family or friends that you shared with. I mean, they are on your side, but they could be subpoenaed for the interview or interrogation. And then if anything was against your memory or anything you said on your side, then it could probably work against you. So it's better to shut up. Silence is golden. It's very hard, but it is here.
You're just right. You don't say anything until you have a good plan.
I see. Okay? That's very important.
Yes,
here.
Right. Mm-hmm. The first step. Mm-hmm. And the second step, you should keep calm and you take a lawyer. Mm-hmm. And after that is write. Please write your timeline.
Timeline.
In detail. It is a very important. Mm-hmm. It is a very good starting point of your case.
How can it help, like writing time, remembering and writing timeline?
In my experience, it is always not enough to write some timeline, my client their own. So I need to discuss with my client about your timeline, his timeline, her timeline. And so I think you need to discuss with your lawyer in detail about your story and make your timeline. And you need to, first of all, you need to sit and make your mind calm and write down exact time, exact place, and what happened to me and what happened to us and what kind of talk we did, and the other things. There are a lot of things to write in your timeline.
I think what he said is that in the sense of supporting your testimony or evidence, the more detailed is the better. So you better sit down and calm, and then bring up your memory, and then do your best you can to remember and recall the memory and write down, you know, every time in the time sequence. That is a second important step.
Yes, right. Timeline as detailed is as detailed as you can, your best. I think you can't remember all things of the event. So you may recall what happened before the event and after the event, and especially in the middle of the event. It is timelines. In every moment, you need to discuss with your lawyer.
I see. So first of all, hiring or appointing very experienced and smart lawyer is the most important thing, I guess. But besides that, there are seven steps that he created.
Okay, okay. As far I am concerned, it is the most strong basis for your argument. So you should write your timeline.
So timeline is done, and then what is next?
Third is witness. The witness. Witness is the very important person of evidence. It's a witness in many ways. Witnesses are very important. You have to bring back your memory. You have to back in the day and have to remember all people relate to your event. So you need to use your timeline.
I see.
But you must not contact them in person.
Oh, really?
Yes. In that case, the witness will be judged by policemen. They are contaminated. By you. The policeman say you, I don't trust them. So the witness won't use your case.
Oh, I see. I mean, normally people would call them up. I mean, you know, I was accused of such and such. I mean, isn't it disgusting, whatever, awful, and talk to the witness, but you should not, you must not. That is very
important. Yes, right. And you you also contaminate them with your thought, with your own thought and feelings, but it doesn't work.
I see.
So you need to be careful to meet in person.
So sometimes contacting and talking to the witness might be viewed as compelling or imposing your own view to them, and it could work against you. Wow, that's very important.
But you don't have a lawyer. You don't hire a lawyer.
Yeah.
In that case, it is very hard to tolerate.
Sure.
Not to meet them in person.
But nobody can stop me. I would go and talk.
Yes, right.
I see.
You need to stop talking with the witnesses in person. It is very dangerous. You can spoil your good witness.
Oh, I see. Mm.
So your lawyer and your lawyer's investigator will be contact for you.
Your lawyer or investigator.
Carefully.
So normal people without this kind of information, they would mistake such kind of things, right? I see. Wow.
Okay.
So what's next?
Next thing is the crime scene, and you need to go your crime scene with your attorney.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, so revisit the crime scene.
Oh, it is a very important thing. Falsely accused by indecent assault by force. In that case, you are not criminals. You are not criminals. So you can go and check your crime scene. I think literally it's not a crime scene, just a scene. We need to check the stuffs, the situations, the place, the size, the room number, or any other things, anything else. It brings you back your memory, a strong memory, and you can make up your timelines more specific.
I see. So this one is also against my own feeling. I mean, I don't want to go. You know, if I'm accused of such an offense, then you know, I don't want to even head my head toward that direction. But you must go to get the memory back, and then your lawyer might be able to see things that you missed. So wow. That's very important.
Yes, right. Most of the clients, my clients, they don't want to go again.
Yeah.
The place, crime
scene. Bad memory.
Yes, bad memory. The worst things happened. But the place where the event occurred can be very important in direct evidence.
Oh, I see.
In our case. So you need to come back, come back with your lawyer and discuss the place, the specific characters of the rooms and room, and so you need to check the crime scene.
I see.
And the next thing about the crime scene, nearby the CCTV, like the direct evidences. These evidences will be faded easily.
Right.
So you need to freeze these evidences. But the evidence preservation protocol is an emergent process.
Yeah.
Of a court of law.
Right. Does the CCTV normally expires after 30 days, or is there a certain period?
Yes, right. They have their period. So you need freeze with your evidence preservation protocol. This is a very rapidly.
You have to act quickly.
Quickly, yes. As quickly as you can. Take your evidence.
I see.
If you are not, the evidence will be perished. You don't use in your case when you want to use.
Oh, I see. So I think this is also one thing that you have to keep in mind. If any those kind of things happen, the CCTVs could expire, the erase after a certain period of time. So with your help, you have to act quickly to preserve the evidence, seize the CCTV. Oh, I see.
Okay. And you need to check your exact, your crime scene. And you need to check around the exact crime scene, such as a CCTV and witnesses and something placed related to your crime scene and a passage to the your crime scene. And this is the indirect evidence in your case.
I happen to have a question. I mean, if the witness is for both sides, I mean, and then the if the what if the witness does not say the truth? I mean, if any she said or she or he says things against me, which is not true, then what you do?
In that case, we need to select what can we do if he or she is strong against us, we don't touch you anymore, but we need to prevent, we need to have some plan for the strong witness against us. But when she or she has ambiguous opinion of the event, and in that case, we need to have our plan and some explain, some clue we can give him or she some clue for thinking for us.
I see. So, I mean, there are many things that you're not aware of that your smart lawyer can do. And then, I mean, the reason I bring this up is that something came up in my mind, and if the witness says any lies, and then say things against me, and then you say, oh, I believe you, you're my friend, and you could not do this to me, it's too late. So if any those kind of things, any hint of those kind of things could happen, you have to talk to your lawyer, and then you have to plan accordingly, and then he, I mean, the lawyer, smart lawyer only can do.
Yes, we will make our own map
mapping.
Winning. So you must tell me all about your case, and you need to make your timeline in detail.
Wow,
and
I see.
You need to tell me as detailed as you can about your witnesses or related to people.
I see. I mean, it sounds like what you say, it sounds like very interesting, but aren't you revealing too much? Is it your business secret, trade secret?
No. I can help you, and I make you win. So I wanna have your smile face.
Thank you.
Okay.
So, what is next after witness and crime scene?
Okay, we have all evidences and all timelines. We have both of them, and we make your true story in detail. And you must tell your love story, your persuasive story. You remember, and we make some confrontation issues.
I see. I get it.
Against the accuser's statement.
Oh, I see. So I think what he says is this is, I mean, tell me if I'm wrong. So now it's your turn to go make your testimony, make statement, and that you know that what the other accuser will say, but which is not true, and then you, you know, force it, and then prepare, and then you make the argument, right?
Yeah, that's right, you're right. Your story is more detail, and your story have to win the accuser's story.
I see.
So you must tell your love story, and you make your own persuasive story based on fact.
Fact, yeah,
not a force.
Sounds like a world plan.
Yes, right. It's a strategy. When you need to make some good strategies.
I see. So you have attacking plan and defense plan both, right?
Yes. You must know your place, your situation, your conversation, your timeline, before the interrogation. And you can have your position
I see.
More useful.
Useful.
More better.
Better.
Much better. And better position.
Way ahead.
You can start your case in your better place.
I see. Oh, wow. Okay. And then what's next?
Okay. It is a very delicate and complicated things we need to talk about. The polygraph.
Polygraph? To whom?
To you.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
For you. And to you. And to the accuser. And the polygraph test or not test. It is a very big question. In my experiences, a client have some tested by polygraph. He has won the case.
Oh, really?
He's true.
I see.
He's saying is true. You win the case. And the other case, the policeman ask him, do you wanna test? He didn't say anything right moment.
I see.
The right moment. But I asked him to have the test because I think the policeman at the moment didn't have any preparation. Without preparation, they don't have any test of the polygraph. So you need the emotional strategy.
I see.
Oh, we want to have the polygraph test, but they don't prepare. They didn't prepare at all. So they don't do that. And
they could be normal.
They think they are very strong. I right. believe.
Yeah.
So
telling the truth.
We need to check more any other statement.
I see. So I think I get the hint. Just by saying that you want to take the polygraph, or if you really do it, they makes your case stronger. I mean, proving that you are telling the truth. So nothing to hide. So there is plus alpha that it is very.
That's right.
Add on to your case, solidify your case. That is right?
Yes, right. So please discuss and decide with your lawyer whether to use the test or not.
But what if, I mean, I've never seen how it looks like, but, you know, talking to or answering to the device, I mean, I could be nervous and I could make mistake. I mean, it could work against me. I mean, isn't it?
In this case, in the case, you should prepare to use private polygraph test.
Oh, is there such a thing?
Yes, right. You can use the private polygraph test. So you need to you can have experience about the test.
Oh, so you can also have a practice sort of by taking private polygraph test. I see.
Yes, right. And in some cases, you can use the test result to give your policeman and investigator and use some result.
Oh, so if the test result comes out good, and then I can submit it and they can be recognized?
Not most case. Some case we can use.
Wow, it doesn't hurt you to submit it if
yes,
the result
right.
is good.
We will we will select to give or not give.
To give or not give.
Yeah, yeah.
To do or not to do.
Yes, always you need to think about use or not use. It is very important in the investigation level.
I see. That is very interesting. I mean, very new.
If you are ready, I recommend you to use the test.
Okay. I mean,
It is very interesting. And there are a lot of sensors attached
sensors.
To your body.
I mean, I could be nervous.
And they need to focus on some issue. And you the answer will be yes or not. Not explained. Just yes or not question.
I see.
If they don't have enough yes or not question, they don't use the test. So they focus. They need to have to focus on the issue of your case. At the moment, they can use the test, polygraph test.
So, I mean, taking polygraph could be helpful and it could work favorable to you.
Yes.
But like if you have to put sensors around you.
Yes.
I mean, just talking to camera makes you nervous, right?
Oh, yes.
Okay. But it could make you nervous and then you could not. You might be able to perform well. And then what are the questions normally of the polygraph?
Polygraph test, the questions are prepared already before you take that time. They have to concentrate on the issues of your case.
I see.
And they make a simple question. You can answer yes or not.
So the question is made so that you can answer either yes or no. So did you do whatever? So
yes, you do or you do, you don't, you did and you didn't.
I see.
Yes, I did. No, I didn't. It's a very simple answer. It can be used.
I see.
In the polygraph test.
Mm-hmm.
So As I mentioned, they don't have any have simple question about the four polygraph test, yes or not question. In that case, they can't use the polygraph test in that level. They don't have simple questions about the case. They don't have the simple answer for the for polygraph test results. So they can't use polygraph tests in that level.
What do you mean the simple question and simple answer is not usable?
No. First of all, the policeman and investigator make some simple question.
Simple question, did you or did you not?
Yes. At the moment, they can use the polygraph test before they make their simple question about the case. They cannot use the polygraph test because they don't have preparations for the testing.
So you mean if they not came. They didn't come up with the questions already.
Come up with the questions already. At the moment, after that, they can use the test, polygraph test. Before the preparation, policeman and investigator, they really want to use the polygraph test, but they can't use.
I see. So the heart of polygraph is the question. So who is making writing the question? Is it well thought out, well devised question or not? Dumb question. They could be critical, right?
Yes, right. So you need to make some noise using your statement against the accuser's statement.
Oh, wow, this is very deep.
Yes, okay.
Secret.
Okay, a pass.
Okay, if you want to know more, okay. Ask him personally.
Okay.
Okay.
And next thing, I think the collective things. Mm-hmm. Are you ready to state mm-hmm. your testimony mm-hmm. in front of your investigator? Your style mm-hmm. and your style of statement mm-hmm. will be ready mm-hmm. enough? Is it good enough?
I see.
This is very important.
Coming to the police station or prosecutors, whoever, and then presenting yourselves mm-hmm. and then presenting your statement,
yes.
you have to be ready. Both sides, you have to get ready to present yourself, and also your statement has to be ready without any flaw, right?
Yes, right. Mm-hmm. You need to prepare the good expression, I think. Mm-hmm. You need to prepare well mentally.
Oh, I see.
And well physically. Mm. Well mm-hmm. expression. It's very important. Mm. And you, please remember, mm-hmm. remember, that you are not there to say what you want. The police station mm-hmm. is the place what you should to say about your case.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the place what you want to say.
I see.
It's a very important thing. Mm. You need to remember. You should remember. You must not forget about that.
Oh, I see. Mm. So you're not there to say mm. things you want to say or explain, but not.
Mm-hmm.
You have to only say things that you should say.
Yes, right. Your statement against you make you go to jail. So you need to prepare and you need to follow your attorney's plan. And you need to say what should you say. It is very important, the last thing.
Oh, I see. Mm. Because people get tempted to say things more because normally, I mean, from my experience mm-hmm. interpretation,
yes.
at the very last stage, the policeman or the prosecutor asks you, is there any more things that you want to say?
Okay.
Or do you should not?
Oh, yes.
There is temptation.
Yes. In my all experiences, men usually end up as sex offenders by lovely statements. Mm-hmm. What they want to say, that what they recall in the moment, temporarily, spontaneously, it is a very, very dangerous thing.
I see.
You need to think about how you will win mm-hmm. The statement of your opponent, mm-hmm. the accuser.
Mm-hmm. I see. So, like we said, this is kind of war plan and playing out according to the war plan. Mm-hmm. And you have to present yourself and the statement, but you have to be ready inside and out, from top to bottom. And then strategy and plan, those two are very important. With your lawyer.
Okay, you're right.
See. So, how about lastly presenting oneself to the prosecutor's office or police station?
Yes.
Is there any important tip that they have to remember?
You need to dress up. You need to dress very good. Mm-hmm. Because the policeman and investigator, they are mm-hmm. human. So they see your appearance
and
they
today?
See your face, your style. They have some prejudice about the criminals. So you don't have to make you seem to criminals.
So you don't want to look like criminals.
You are innocent people, innocent person. You look like an innocent person to your investigator. So you need to dress up.
Dress up, then down.
Mm-hmm. And borrow some good clothes and makeup.
Ah, I see.
Your face and smile.
Smile.
And think you are the innocent person.
I see.
In the moment.
So like, I mean, I happen to think of that gentleman like him shows up for to make statement. Nobody would think that he did such a thing. And then, of course, you must be innocent. So dress up, then dress down, and then dress charmingly. That
yes,
is
right.
Also important because all the investigator of and whatnot, they are all human. So it is also important. So if somebody like this gentleman shows up to make statement, nobody would think that that person committed such a crime. So how you look, how you present yourself is very important. So don't take it casual. So dress up, then dress down, and then make your best to present yourself.
Yes,
I
right.
think that is helpful and critical. And then I also heard that in the very beginning, you mentioned this, the court deals with it as a serious crime and
yes.
mostly felony. And then if any foreigner residing in Korea,
yes.
it could be serious to them, right?
Yes, right. It, the issue is deportation.
Oh.
Yeah. Deportation is a very severe issue
sure.
For foreigners in Korea. Especially in this case, the sexual offenders case, our friendly foreigners, they will have a very big danger about deportation process. So you should check up your deportation process in your case. And we have worked for the foreigners about the deportation process. We did well. We have done well the case. And so we have to prepare about the two tracks, a criminal case and the deportation, the immigration case.
Oh, this is very the most critical thing. I mean, if you are accused of this offense, and then fighting or defending this case is important, but if it's and is connected, rightly connected to
yes.
the deportation or immigration case, and then if you are a student or a worker or married and live here, and then you want to plan to live here, and then if you had if you're ordered to deport, then your life is ruined, completely collapsed. So this is something you might have to keep in mind, and also in Lowin, not only he speaks English, but they have like interpreters
yes, right.
Can help you interpretation while investigation, while court. So I mean, yeah, this is something you might wanna remember.
Okay. Yeah.
And so many things he shared. I mean, it is very good. Thank you very much. But we made this session, so anyone who viewed this video can benefit, and so they never be a victim or offender of sex crimes. So we achieve our goal. And then Jacob, thank you very much again.
Okay, thank you. If you are falsely accused by indecent or a sexual offenders, in that case, you we can help you, and we protect your personality, your dignity. Okay, and thank you for watching our video. It was my pleasure today. Stay safe. We will come again. See you soon.
He's so sweet. And we'll come back again. Thank you very much.